a couple of exciting things that I want to mention about the announcements. If you missed it, I want to reiterate this so you have no excuse, okay? On December 29th, we're moving to one service at 9:30 a.m. all of the way until March 8th will be our final service, one service, 9:30 a.m. Just to clarify, how many services? One. All right, someone will miss it. They're like, I didn't know. And they'll show up at 10:45, even though they just heard us say that. What? How many services? At what time? So 10 o'clock is okay to show up? Yeah, some of you are habitually late. There's nothing we can do. We could lie to you and say it's at 7:15 and you'll still show up at 9:45. It's okay. There's grace for you, I promise. So one service, 9:30. It will also help if you share this with people that you are going to be bringing to church in 2020. We know that's on the top of your New Year's resolution, is to be a cleverly disguised missionary, encourage people to come into redemptive environments where they can hear the good news of Jesus. And so you're probably wondering at this point in the service, why there's all of these dapper-looking individuals behind me. It is a talent show. And it's going to be quiet charades, and you have to guess what their talent is. It'll be exciting. No, what we're doing today is, this is the fourth week of Advent. We're going to be talking about love. We're going to be answering the question, what is love? What is love? Okay. No. There we go. That's all I needed. Thank you, Jordan. That was great. We're going to be answering that question as we look at the person and the work and the story of Jesus. As we've remembered in the last couple of weeks, Anthony's helped us with this, that Advent is remembering the future. That we can easily lose sight of Jesus in the manger and forget that you know, we can hold on to the message of the cradle and forget the message of the cross. And so we are remembering the promises of God, both in the birth and the arrival of the Savior of the world, that this is the one who will redeem all of our pain and suffering, and the one who comes to restore all righteousness, restore all of our hopes and dreams and everything that has been lost as a result of the fall. And so in the person and work of Jesus, we're asking, what is love and what does this mean? And so today we're going to hear four different sermons. They're going to be 45 minutes each. Someone's like, Brandon, you've never preached a 45-minute service. That's not true. There will be many sermons in which we're going to use all of the lectionary texts that help tell the story of the Advent. So there are going to be four entirely different takes on maybe what the message of Advent in the fourth week is, how we see Jesus as love in the text, and what God wants to do for us as a result. And so without any further ado, would you help me in welcoming our first preacher for the day, Emily Parrott.
Good morning, good news. It's my pleasure to give you a little mini sermon this morning. We are going to be spending a brief moment talking about this passage in Isaiah, and I believe, Kelly, you have it on the slide. And I'm just going to begin. We're not going to do the stand up, sit down, because we're going to have to do that a lot this morning. But if you would just focus on the screen, we're going to read this passage from Isaiah 7. It says, again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights. But Ahaz says, I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. He will be eating curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right. For before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid waste. So this morning we're in the fourth Sunday of Advent, which is the Sunday that focuses on the theme of love. And our main idea for my little sermon this morning is that love is presence. And we're going to talk about that word Emmanuel. It's that name for Jesus that means God with us. But before we talk about that, I wanted to tell you a little story. And since I have you all here as a captive audience, I'm going to tell you a story about my kids because you have to listen. we've got a actually almost four-year-old. Audrey's birthday is tomorrow, so if you see her, wish her happy birthday. And we have a one-and-a-half-year-old, Wesley. And, you know, Anthony and I kind of have this pretty steady routine in our lives during the work week. At the end of the day, we go, we pick up our kids from daycare, we come home, and we have this precious few hours with our kids before they go to bed. We are the parents that put our kids to bed early. And so we have kind of this policy that for those couple of hours, we try to be really intentional in being present with them. It's a way that we can show our love to them. And so we are not perfect at this. It does not happen every time, but we try to put our phones away. We try to, you know, get on the floor with them, get to their level, hear stories about their day, play with them, engage with them. And you know, what's funny is I was thinking about this theme of love being presence. I thought about how it doesn't matter if we're just talking with them, if we're reading a book or whatever, it inevitably turns to wrestling. It doesn't matter how we're engaging with them, how calm they are. Within a matter of minutes, they end up wrestling with us. Mostly Anthony, let's be honest. Like all of a sudden we become these human jungle gyms. They're climbing all over us. They're hugging us, hanging on us. Parents, you know that like hanging where they never let go, and they're wrestling on the floor. And it just struck me that that their need for love for us comes in this very physical, present form. And so as we talk, I want to share a little bit about how God has been with us physically from the beginning. And I think oftentimes we look at the birth of Jesus and we see this very obvious, tangible, God was physically with us. But I also wanted to share a little bit this morning about how God has been with his people from the beginning. So I kind of want to run real quick, since I don't have a lot of time, I'm just going to run through a list of ways that God has been with his people, even in the Old Testament. So first off, we have the Garden of Eden, where God is walking with Adam and Eve, and that's in Genesis 3. We have Isaac in Genesis 26 and his dealings with the Philistines. God was with him. And we know God was with Joseph in Egypt in Genesis 39. And then you have Moses in the tabernacle, and God led the Israelites with a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And that's in Exodus 40. We have David, who before he was even king, the Bible says that Saul was afraid of David because God was with David in 1 Samuel. We have Asa, who is a repentant king in 2 Chronicles. And because of that repentance, it says God was with him. We have Hezekiah, who's a righteous king, mentioned in 2 Kings. And it says God was with him because of his righteousness. And we have Ezra, a priest, who King Cyrus declared that God was with the people of Israel in Ezra 1. So we can kind of see, even in that brief list, that God has been with his people from the beginning. It didn't just start with Jesus. This morning, from our passage in Isaiah, I really wanted to kind of focus in on verse 14. It says, "Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." Or as John 1:14 says, "The word became flesh and made his dwelling among us." Part of the way that God shows his love for us is through the physical incarnation. Emmanuel, God with us. God literally placed himself among us through Jesus. And when you love with someone, one of the ways of showing it is to be with them. Let me say that again. When you love someone, one of the ways of showing it is to be with them. And it's interesting to track this progression of how God is with his people in the Bible. As we talked about with that list from the Old Testament, we can see that God, kind of in the Old Testament, almost is able to kind of come alongside us. We can see that he's showing up with certain people at certain times and certain circumstances. And then with the birth of Jesus, we can see that God is with us physically present in person. And now in this present age that Jesus, we know that Jesus has died, he's been resurrected, and he has ascended, that he is in us. Or maybe more accurately, we are in Christ. His spirit indwells each and every one of us, making us his temple. So if we know that, if we can see a God who has been with us from the beginning and yearning and striving and longing to be present with us, that we can see that part of love is presence. And how does that shape the way we love those around us? Who do we need to show up for? Who do we need to sit with? Where is our presence needed? Thank you.
Oh, so good. So as we continue in the liturgical tradition, after the Old Testament reading, a psalm is read in response. And so today, our second reading is going to come from Psalm 80. And there's going to be just a short list of first scriptures there. And to answer the question of what is love, I have the task of defining that. And through Psalm 80, I would give you this as the main idea, that love is the fulfillment of a long-awaited promise. Love is the fulfillment of a long-awaited promise. In a novel by George MacDonald called The Vicar's Daughter, there's a character named Winnie, who is the narrator of the story. And she recalls her father's wisdom. She says, "My father says that a true faith is like the pool of Bethesda. It is when it is troubled that it shows its healing power." I'll read that one more time. "That a true faith is like the pool of Bethesda. It is when it is troubled that it shows its healing power." You know, unfortunately, I think we enter into this season of Christmas when our lows seem to get lower, when our feelings of loneliness seem to get lonelier, when our poverty, which unfortunately is often relational and monetary, can I get a witness, is really put on display. When our reality threatens our very existence because this isn't the way I thought things were going to be. If I see another Peloton commercial, I'm going to go crazy. Am I right? They're physically fit people living in, you know, $2.5 million homes, and they're all models, and I just don't understand it. Like, this isn't the way I thought my life was going to be. Every time I brush my teeth without my shirt on in the morning, I think, God, this is not what you intended for me. I know some of you are with me in the same place. In an age of excitement, in an age of just constant information, Christmas does one thing, and it highlights the suffering in the world. And I find this to be an interesting thing in our lives, because we're called to be living in the middle between a tension. That on one hand, yes, it feels like everything is going down the wastebasket, if you will. But on the other hand, God is going to redeem the world through the birth of his son, Jesus Christ. And there's this interesting tension of, we live between these two places. It's not the way I thought it was going to be, yet God is going to do something. And I often find that the very real middle tension is this, that everyone else seems to be enjoying the promises of God that I think I should be enjoying too. Who gave you the right to smile? Who gave you the right to enjoy? But yet I know this foundational truth that runs in the back of my mind. God is still good, and he's still set on redeeming us. Psalm 80 shows us the balance of Christian pain and suffering and God's redemption, and that God's love is the fulfillment of a long-awaited promise, even if it feels like it's never going to end. So in Psalm 80, the psalmist uses a unique set of phrases here to describe the reality of God's people. So this is a psalm of lament. We're not really good on lament. I'm the worst person in the world on lament. I will give you a positive experience over my negative emotion. And so this is a plea for God's help in the midst of crisis. And so the psalmist says in verses 4-5, "How long, Lord God Almighty, will your anger smolder against the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of tears." Listen to this. "You have made them drink tears by the bowl full." It helps us beg the question that in the midst of our difficulty, in the midst of our suffering, we ask this question of, like, where are you, God, and what are you doing? And in verse 1 of the passage, it calls God the shepherd of Israel. This is the same God who cares for us and shepherds his flock. But one of the questions I have to ask out of this text is, what kind of shepherd feeds their sheep tears? And like, it's not just like a little bit of tears. It's not just a little bit of suffering, but it's like by the truckload, load and load. It says, "You've given me bowlfuls of tears." And like, the most great equivalent in the English language is like, is if God is pouring down your throat kegs upon kegs upon kegs of anguish and suffering. But an interesting point to make in this passage, if you were to read it on your own, is that the passage shows us no indication of the people ditching God because things got hard, because it didn't go the way that they wanted it to. And really, like, if we read the passage, it sounds as if they're blaming God for the way things are. But there's this repeated phrase that keeps happening. Restore us, God Almighty. Make your face shine on us that we may be saved. It's almost as like in the middle of our suffering, in the middle of our pain, there's a message of healing, hope, and redemption. And this psalm gives us an insight that we need. That whenever it gets hard, whenever it feels hopeless, whenever it feels too far gone, God is still going to show up. In the opening story where we used that brief quote from George MacDonald's novel, and we talked about the Pool of Bethesda in John chapter 5, that this is an incredible story, that an angel kind of stirs up this pool of water, and then if you're the first to get in and get out whenever it stirs up, you receive this miraculous gift of healing. That it will take things getting a little murky. It will take our hope getting dangled on its final thread. But yet we are still sustained for the healing power of God because it's about to begin. This is our message. This is the hope that we have in Jesus. When we're on our last inch, on our last breath, when we've already spent the last dollar, God still promises that he will deliver us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. I love 2 Corinthians 4. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. In the scope of eternity, in the scope of God's glory being revealed to us in the person of Jesus face to face, everything that we will endure feels like it's kind of nothing in the grand picture. That's not to dismiss our pain. That's not to dismiss our suffering, but it is the hope. It's the light at the end of the tunnel. It's the thing that we cannot see. And so in this psalm, we're given a strategy. And he allows the psalmist to drink God's bowl full of tears. And I find it so interesting of like, we really love self-help books, 7, you know, highly effective habits of whatever, happy people, and, you know, 4 rules for healthy living, and you basically just eat cardboard and you'll live to be 105. And room temperature Dr. Pepper, because some old lady in Connecticut did it. But this doesn't give us that same foundation, doesn't give that same strategy. It says that in order to drink the bowl full of tears, it's to put our trust in the Lord, who can make his face shine on us that we may be saved. I love how the church father Augustine says it so well about the underlying trust of God. I know it's like it's hard when it's difficult, when everything is stacked against us. Why would we still have trust in God? He said that God's hidden hand of healing art works contrary to the program of our own plans and will. Sometimes things don't go the way that you want them to go. And this is what he says. Inside me, your good was working on me. Inside me. To make me restless until you should become clear and certain to my inward sight. Through the hidden hand of your healing art, my swelling abated, and from day to day, the troubled and clouded sight of my mind grew better through the stinging ointment of a healthy sorrow. Pain may come in the night, but joy comes in the morning. There may be moments of suffering, but in Christ, whether now or later, our longings, wants, desires, loneliness, woes are met and satisfied. Our deepest longings, our deepest pains and sufferings satisfied in the completed work of Jesus Christ. Love is the fulfillment of a long-awaited promise.
And love grants a new lease on life. When Walter Elias was a child, his favorite pastime was drawing. With pen and ink, he could create beautiful fantasy lands where everyone was happy and he was in control. Walter dropped out of high school and at the age of 16 to serve as an ambulance driver in France during World War I. Upon returning from the war, to a home in Kansas City, his home state of Missouri, he resumed his passion of drawing. He had a meager wage working in advertising and eventually lost his home. He had to live out of his office, and he ate cold pork and beans out of a can. I love that, Jay says, gee. He moved to Los Angeles in 1923, and with management help from his older brother, Roy, he began to prosper. He created a character called Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, which turned out to be not so lucky when Walter Elias allowed the copyright to be under his employer's name and not his own. Thinking back to the days of living out of his office and eating cold beans, he remembered the mice who used to play in the wastebasket as he was drawing late into the night. One mouse in particular seemed quite playful, and Walter Elias went on to create Mickey Mouse. And now you know the rest of the story of Walt Disney. Walt Disney's been dead almost as long as I've been alive. He passed away in 1966. But he has brought feature film animation and theme parks to all the world. He was granted a new lease on life, a fresh start, more than one time. And in Paul's letter to the Romans, he introduces himself as a person called and granted a new lease on life. Paul's been given a fresh start, a new way of living. This main idea, love granting a new lease on life, comes to us from Romans chapter 1. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, regarding his son, who as to this earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him we received grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. And you are also among those Gentiles who are called to belong to Jesus Christ, to all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be his holy people. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. What jumped off the page to me when I read this scripture, and what I feel like Jesus' message is to you today, is how he used the word call or called. He uses it four times in this passage. And so from the bottom up, I'm going to talk about three different kinds of call. Jesus personally appears to Paul, as we've read in Acts 9, and grants him an entirely new lease on life, a 180, if you will. Paul felt that he was doing the work of God Almighty by persecuting Christians and subduing this movement, but he had gotten it wrong. The first call is a general call, to gather with Christians, to learn, to summon others, and to belong. Some of us had a choice in whether or not we came to be part of a body of Christians, whether we came to learn, and some of us did not. My parents just brought me, but that is a call. If you're in this room, you are called to be here. You're not here by mistake. We've been praying for you. We've been praying for the mission of good news to reach all people. The second call is the effectual call. In verse 5, where you're called, you're given an urgent task of passing it on, perhaps to your neighbor, perhaps to the children around you, perhaps from one generation to another. The experience, the new lease on life that comes from a knowledge of Jesus Christ and his saving grace, allows us to enter into an obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. We are given the call to pass it on. We believe it so deeply, we want others to know. And thirdly, it's Paul's introduction. Paul feels the need to qualify himself, to explain to the people. And he's not calling every Roman citizen. He's calling those, he's inviting those to read this letter who have already had the work of Jesus going on in their hearts, who are already entering into learning more about Jesus Christ. And so Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, gives us a sense that Paul is authorized to carry this precious message. He's God's spokesperson. So let's follow our call of Jesus by bringing the message of God's love through his son, Jesus Christ, to the world around us. Tell everyone how love granted you a new lease on your life to be his holy people. We are part of his story.
Good morning. I'd like to spend my time this morning with you exploring one final way that God's love shows up in our lives, and that's the mysterious, the supernatural way in which he provides peace to us amidst the storms of our lives, and more specifically that God's love provides a stillness amidst chaos. And as we meet here this morning, we're 3 days away from Christmas Day, and I have to think that there's a lot of chaos going on within the individuals and the families within this room, whether that looks like last-minute gifts that need to be purchased or travel that's upcoming. Perhaps there's some in-laws you're going to see later this week that you're not too excited about. There's just a lot going on, and I have to think that that's true for many of us. Or maybe the busyness of this season has just made you tired and you're weary. Perhaps you can see that on my face. I know that's the case for me and my family. Maybe you can see the bags under my eyes and just a weary look. I know I can see that on many of your faces this morning. Not naming any names, of course, but I have to think that this is a common experience with us today. Going beyond that, perhaps the chaos that you're experiencing right now runs a little bit deeper and has a little bit more meaning. Maybe this is the first Christmas that you're having without a loved one, and that's weighing on you. Perhaps there's a relationship that's fraying, or you're struggling with a career. There's lots of forms of chaos that we all experience. If we can agree that we're all living with some form of chaos, I'd like to look to the Christmas story as told in Matthew and try to identify some ways that God showed his love amidst the chaos of that first Advent story. So if you would read with me from Matthew chapter 1, starting at verse 18. The story goes, "This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary His mother, Mary, was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.' All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, 'The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel,' which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus." So I think it's really great to read that succinct telling of the Christmas story and understand really how earth-changing that story was. But this morning, I'd like to focus specifically on the experience of Joseph and look at the chaos that he was experiencing in this passage. And so after the angel had come to Mary and informed her of her call, the role that she was going to play in bringing Jesus into the earth, and she accepted that call, she went away for a few months to visit her cousin Elizabeth. And in that time, Joseph became aware of Mary's pregnancy. And I have to think that finding out that your fiance was pregnant and knowing that it was not your own child is a little bit chaotic, and it makes the busy day I had to spend at Walmart fighting the traffic and finding a checkout line seem kind of trivial. But in that chaos, I think God showed up and showed his love in a few different ways. I think first we read in verse 19 that he allowed Joseph to wrestle with this new information, to think through what should he do, what does this mean. God allowed him to apply his wisdom and his knowledge to come up with a plan to try to do the right thing to Mary. And then as we see that Joseph had really exhausted all he could do to navigate this chaos, we see the second way that God showed his love. He sent the angel in a dream, and the angel started by affirming Joseph. He's saying, Joseph, you are a son of God, son of David, reminding him that he is loved by God and that the Messiah was to come through David's line. The angel here started by really encouraging and reminding Joseph that he is special. And finally, the angel gives Joseph the information that he needs. He affirms the call on Joseph's life. He says, yes, this baby is indeed of the Holy Spirit. Go and play your role, answer your call to bring Jesus into the world. And we see that Joseph obeyed. So how does this apply to us? What can we take away from that today? I think succinctly that our chaos may not look exactly like Joseph's does. It may not look the same as the person sitting next to you, but I think we can be assured that just as God showed his love to Joseph in the Christmas story, he shows his love to us, and he will bring stillness to our chaos. Just as Joseph had to wrestle with this new information, I think we're called to wrestle with the chaos that's in our lives, that we're to do our best to navigate it, to seek out ways that we can best handle the chaos. But going beyond that, God is encouraging us. He's not telling us we're a son of David. He's telling us we are a son of the king or a daughter of the king. He's encouraging us and building us up. And finally, I can't tell you that you're going to have an angel come to you in a dream tonight and tell you exactly how you can navigate this chaos, but I can tell you that we have a new form of God with us, Emmanuel. We have the Holy Spirit available to us each and every day to give us guidance and direction and to help us best navigate what's going on in our lives. So as we go into this next week of perhaps even more chaos and craziness, it's my prayer that we would each be reminded that God will show us his love by providing stillness amidst it. Thank you.
That was so good. Can we give it up for all of our teaching team members? That was phenomenal. If you don't know who's on stage, we have Emily Parrott, Sally Idas, Brett Vandehoof, and then myself, Brandon Morrow. And so this is a group of people, minus Jesse Ortel, who had to be out of town for work today, who has labored over the last couple of years to be lay teachers and preachers, and they have done a phenomenal job. And one of the things I love that they can add is a very real, that's not Brandon or Anthony, presence to our church to say, this is the word of God that's accessible to all people, and in it you can find life. And I love today how we answered the question of what is love, or how can we understand love in light of this season, in light of who Jesus is. One of the things that we like to do in our home is we like to teach our kids like small Bible verses. We're not very good at it. We're not very consistent, so they only know like two of them. But one of them is a really basic one in 1 John 4:8. We basically just really simple it down for our kids of God is love. And in this season, we are seeing that God is love. And this particular love has a name, and it is Emmanuel, God with us, in the person and work of Jesus Christ. I love at the beginning of Hebrews kind of asking the question, it's almost hidden in the text, of who is Jesus? Who is this God? Or how do we understand and view God in light of the Old Testament, in light of the way that we've traditionally read Scripture? And it says that Jesus is God. And everything that we thought God to look like, if we understand who God is, how he acts, we look at the person and work of Jesus. He is the exact representation of his character, his glory revealed to us. And today we see that fully realized as we hear the reading of the Advent story, as we're reminded of the texts. And I will just say this, if you didn't find at least one sermon for you today, we want you to go back online. It'll be live stream. You can watch it on YouTube. But there is a moment of hope. There is a message of healing. There is a reminder of God's physical presence in your life, his accessibility. That in this time and in this season, we want to, I hate to be like so cheesy, but like Jesus is the reason for the season. Can I get an amen? but we should feast our eyes on the King of Kings and on the Lord of Lords. That it's easy for us to just gather upon the cuteness and the beauty and the wonder of the infant son Jesus. But today we heard the story of his power, of his might, of the things that he has done and he still has yet to do. The way he wants to turn the world upside down, call us to a new thing, but yet also ease the endless anxiety that is in our own heart and in our own mind. Our invitation for you to church, for you today as the church, is to recognize that Jesus is love. And in him, we find the full essence of love, the full understanding of love, and our hearts get rejuvenated when we return to him so that we may love others.